Thank you, Andy. That's an excellent talk to follow. So there are a heady mix of anti-vaccine claims made around COVID-19. Some are startlingly improbable, even from a cursory glance, such as the notion that vaccines contain microchips that are then used to track people. And some of those ideas have already been mentioned. But many of these, as also mentioned, have a veneer of respectability, however thin. One claim, for example, is that mRNA-based vaccines operate by altering human DNA, which then conjures associations with mutation. This is not the case, but for those who do not know the science as fully as those who have dedicated their lives to such vaccines, and I include myself in that group, it can be made to sound plausible. Debunked claims also include that the vaccine will cause infertility in women, or that it can result in antibody-dependent enhancement and overreaction of the human immune system. These types of claims proliferate then on blogs, online videos, and social media status updates shared on groups built around spreading such fears and concerns. Many of the concerns stem from older fears of vaccines, such as those debunked claims that gravitate around Andrew Wakefield's fraudulent 1998 paper inventing a link between MMR vaccines and cases of the entirely fictional autistic enterocolitis condition. Although equally, the reasons for the low uptake of the anti-vaccine movement here might also be partly based on the legacy of Wakefield and his very public debunking, which remains strong, I think, in the minds of many in the British public. What has not been debunked, and this has already been referenced, that there are dangers around vaccine that, however slight or real, is a specific claim related to the AstraZeneca vaccine, with I think about 10 in every million doses resulting in an incredibly rare blood clotting condition. And in a few of those cases, this has even resulted in death. This is obviously a cause for concern and in many instances, deeply tragic. It also does not outweigh the advantages of the vaccine for most recipients, and anti-vaccine narratives will obviously not weight the extensive dangers of COVID-19 when reviewing this risk, but prefer to inflate particular tragedies. Anti-lockdown arguments, meanwhile, center on more generalized claims about COVID-19 itself, the numbers of deaths and the idea that cases are exaggerated. And this is then set against other alleged risks, often very vague, associated with things like mental health results of lockdown, etc. There's little evidence often given beyond anecdotes and speculation, but undoubtedly these do draw from real experiences that people have, that people find these conditions very difficult. So people come to these views for any number of reasons, with a huge number of sort of potential sources and theories and so on. And it's really sort of hard to understand how this coheres in the movement, given that the benefits of these measures are so vast and the empirical pretext for rejecting them so flimsy. And so we have to ask, why has it become a movement? A significant factor compounding the problem concerns, I think, and I think Annie's already covered this quite well, the approach of the government. And I think this partly helps explain how we arrived at this situation. Amber countries, eat out to help out, corrupt PPE, these are not a good foundation for a coherent health strategy. But given all of this, should we even attempt to uncover a politics for the anti-lockdown movements? Is it not just disparate people with a range of motives, even degrees of conviction, uniting only in a shared confusion? I would argue against this, that we should uncover the politics beneath this movement, not because every individual attends anti-lockdown rallies or posts anti-vaccine conspiracy theories as all of one mind, but because there is nonetheless a clear organizing force at work, bringing atomized people together. Alone, the bad government approach could explain discontent, but not a sustained movement against lockdown and vaccines that lacks any credible claims to underscore its argument. why has this discontent not, for example, expressed itself only in the demand for a coherent approach, such as that advocated by Zero COVID? Josephine Armistead, in her essay, The Silicon Ideology, examines the new highly online manifestations of the far right, sometimes called alt-right and neo-reactionary, etc., terms that are all sometimes useful and sometimes not, depending upon the context. But she describes the, quote, ideological predecessor of neo-reactionary thought, namely the techno-utopian right libertarianism pervasive in the tech industry. When KCL's Claire Crawford observes the libertarian rhetoric at the heart of the anti-lockdown and anti-vaccine movement then, it is worth pausing on the connection between right-wing libertarian ideas and the far right more generally. The anti-lockdown movement claims to be first and foremost about freedom. If there is a unifying theme here, that is definitely it. This is their primary trick, I would argue, to obscure their real politics. I've got an extensive quote from Crawford's essay here, and I think it's worth quoting in full because it establishes the point quite well. She writes, "Lately, I have regularly drifted into the anti-mask, anti-vaccine, anti-lockdown UK Twitter sphere. Popular hashtags include masks off, no to lockdown, and KBF, keep Britain free. These are references to muzzles, which discursively link the issue to free speech, debates, and appropriation of the abortion rights movement's language with hashtags like My Body, My Choice and Pro-Choice. There are frequent comparisons between mask wearing and slavery, and yellow stars embellished with I am exempt or no to vaccine passports in font intended to resemble Hebrew. Many of these accounts will make statements about freedom and liberty of speech, of thought, from lockdown, from the state, from lies, from tyranny. While this is an ideologically mixed or even confused digital space, many here identify as libertarians. Anti-fascist work in the US has frequently made a link between right-wing libertarianism and fascism. And there is a phrase, the libertarian to fascist pipeline, that expresses this quite neatly. There's been a notable trend of online libertarian micro-celebrities to travel in a Trumpian or even more explicitly fascistic direction, which has been reserved by researchers, journalists, and activists. Many in the so-called rationalist, skeptic, and atheist spheres of the noughties YouTube ecology would migrate to anti-feminism and the reactionary manosphere, and then to the alt-right, racial pseudoscience, and more general conspiracy theory. And all the while they retain a libertarian rhetoric, as well as a fondness for South Park-style irreverence and shock humor. This is the basis that serves as the backdrop for anti-lockdown sentiments in the UK, even if it is a heavily US one. One Unite for Freedom protest in London drew a special attention for featuring a British Union of Fascists flag. This symbol of old-fashioned fascism, while rightly shocking, is a grotesque relic. The same could not be said of the symbols around Trump, QAnon conspiracy theorists, those wearing the fascist thin blue line pro-police symbol, and so on, all also resident quite frequently at these rallies. The internet, as Annie has shown, is key to today's far right, and therefore to anti-lockdown and vaccine conspiracies, QAnon and their ilk, representing an older demographic than the countercultural trolling fascists on 8chan Anon boards and elsewhere to greet on Facebook groups where typically an older demographic hangs out. But the core here is quite similar. And while social media companies are trying to reverse some of the damage in this culture war, they are finding it predictably difficult. Online spaces are hard to control even for the companies that own them, as the very architecture of the internet favors easily consumed sensationalist and shallow content, an apt description of any anti-vax or anti-lockdown propaganda. The movement looks to a number of strange luminaries, and some of these have already been mentioned, but you can add to Lawrence Fox and Piers Corbin, David Icke, famous for popularizing the idea that there are shape-shifting lizard people, until he found that slightly too weird to, you know, ride on. There's also people like the Tory MP Desmond Swain, who's perhaps less known, but has contributed a lot of material backing to these movements. Such people are sometimes difficult to take seriously, as I think the general far right often is, but I think that impulse is a mistake. They are capable of pulling thousands to their marches, legitimizing and mainstreaming their views. What is undeniable about all of these people is that they are extreme reactionaries to their core, and identify in this cause something useful to furthering a more general politics that they hold. The factors that result in some people personally coming to question a sound public health approach to the pandemic would not in themselves result in such a movement. Just as the false autism to and MMR link was made by a tiny number of parents before Wakefield, it required Wakefield's intervention to create a movement. So we could expect an organic but trivial number of people to adopt these views around COVID-19 and prevention, but it requires leadership and a single broad ideological narrative framework to make it something more dangerous. Crawford rightly observes, quote, the theoretical libertarian foundations and the more outlandish conspiracy theories fueling the anti-lockdown movement are from the US context, and more specifically, they are white supremacist. She is right. Even if that does not mean that everyone caught up in these movements is wholeheartedly a white supremacist. Still, a further caveat hinted before needs to be added. In June, The Guardian reported that one in four elderly Black people in this country are not vaccinated, compared to only 10% of white people in the same demographic. Vaccine hesitancy does not only have one cause, even if the primary movement that encourages it is one deeply tied to white supremacy. An earlier study of the reasons for hesitancy in Black and other minority ethnic demographics showed, to quote The Guardian directly, nearly half of the BAME people who said they would not have the vaccine said that they would refuse it due to lack of information. Almost 2 in 5 said they believed it was unsafe, while a quarter said they would not trust the science behind it or simply did not want it. Similarly, it has been indicated that people in the queer community are likelier to be vaccine hesitant, at least in the US. The fear of such groups stems from systemic power imbalances rather than ideology rooted in the preservation of power, as we find with the mainstay of the anti-lockdown right. The motives here are different to that behind QAnon, although there is nothing preventing the anti-lockdown movement from hiding behind such hesitancy amongst the oppressed. Our response must be to call out such bad faith for what it is. Clearly, from the movement's wider associations, QAnon and the other anti-lockdown groups and individuals are no friends of the oppressed, caring about them only insofar as it furthers their anti-public health goals. The truth is that in the context of widespread societal structural racism and a history of colonialism with present-day consequences, a history that includes outright medical experimentation on Black people and anti-queer medical gatekeeping, distrust of the medical establishment has deep historical justifications from the impacted groups. This can only be overcome, however, through an anti-racist, queer liberationist, but nonetheless politically clear message. After these very communities have been shown to be especially vulnerable to the pandemic, a low uptake of the vaccine compounds rather than responds to injustices. To tackle this hesitancy, however, injustices cannot be swept aside. They must be tackled directly. And governments such as the British one is patently unable to do so, I would say, for very obvious reasons. Broadly speaking, then, it is the far right that owns and dominates the anti-lockdown, anti-vaccination rhetoric and movement. While we should always be aware of the two-sidedness of social phenomena, we need to see past the shallow trappings of these currents to identify the ugly reality. It would be wrong, I believe, to make vaccines mandatory, to have the state enforce them on everyone, as the far right like to fantasize in their self-justificatory stories. Such a non-solution would bypass deeper problems of social solidarity by appealing directly to state power, reinforcing the very atomization and despair that gave rise to some of these problems in the first place. But we need to project a message that is clear. Vaccines are fundamental to overcoming COVID-19. The concerns around them are exaggerated and often baseless. What does such a far right have to gain from this calculation of aligning with anti-vaccine and anti-lockdown movements? I would argue that by playing on the fears and problems of the most atomized layers of society, layers that are often fueled by resentments against the oppressed, all while co-opting and distorting the language of oppression, they cement a force that can be turned to other ends. This is helped along by foregrounding a conception of freedom rooted only in property ownership and negative liberty, one that implicitly forecloses the social change needed for those excluded from power to liberate themselves. The idea of freedom at the core of the reactionary movement is part of the point. Freedom to live free of social responsibility, freedom to dominate others, is not a freedom worthy of the name. This is the freedom of minority rule extended to its most absurd breaking point. How do we counter a far right that dresses its conspiracies and opposition even to public health in the language of emancipation and freedom, often to the point of outright parodying the movements of the oppressed as well as the left? We must make a positive case for an enabling freedom, a freedom to live one's life fully, a freedom that is furthered by overcoming COVID-19. This is surely at the core of the struggle for zero COVID. In her piece, Crawford perceptively draws from Frantz Fanon's work. I would like to draw to an end here with a quote from someone indebted to Fanon, Paulo Freire. I might be mangling his name. He wrote, "Men and women rarely admit their fear of freedom openly, however, tending rather to camouflage it, sometimes unconsciously by presenting themselves as defenders of freedom. They give their doubts and misgivings an air of profound sobriety as befitting the custodians of freedom. Zero COVID needs to articulate a liberating vision around vaccines, freed from the trappings of this false far-right libertarian-style concept of freedom. Masks, lockdowns, and vaccines need to be framed in terms of social solidarity, shared agency, and the drive for a freer world. At the same time, there can be no ground given to far-right adjacent arguments that fuel the anti-lockdown movement. These will not always be clear in their origin, and sometimes such arguments are made wholly in good faith. The best counter, finally, is to emphasize the liberating potential of a zero COVID strategy, not the freedom of someone to infect others with a debilitating and sometimes deadly virus, but the freedom to live in a world without the threat of COVID-19. Thank you.